السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. We always begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon the Prophet Moses, Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, Jesus, Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, Abraham, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, and all the Prophets until our father Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this gathering of ours, and may He the Almighty make the angels shroud us with their wings. May the sakina, tranquility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descend upon us. And may Allah the Almighty envelop all of us with His rahmah. And may He the Almighty make high mention of us in the seven heavens. Inshallah ta'ala, for today's talk, we will be touching on an amazing hadith. A beautiful and an amazing hadith, and this hadith is known as the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salatu wassalam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this hadith, like I said, is a famous hadith, is a well-known hadith, it is an authentic hadith, and it has been recorded by Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Ahmad, Imam al-Tirmidhi, Imam ibn Majah, Imam ibn Hibban, and so many other imams in many, many books of hadith. It is an authentic hadith, and it is a famous hadith, a very beautiful hadith, a hadith from which pearls can be derived, so many lessons can be derived. Allahu Akbar. So inshallah ta'ala, for today's talk, we will be grazing in this beautiful garden, in this beautiful garden of this hadith, where we shall derive many blessings and many benefits and many lessons inshallah ta'ala. So like I said, there are many narrations in regard to this hadith. There are many narrations. The hadith has come about in many books of hadith. But for today's talk, we will be sticking to the narration of Imam Muslim rahimahullah, because the narration of Imam Muslim rahimahullah is the longer version of this particular hadith, unlike the other versions of the hadith. The other versions of the hadith start off from بَيْنَمَا نَحْنُ جُلُوسُنَا عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. And as we go, I will explain in regard to that. Nevertheless, we will be sticking to the narration of Imam Muslim rahimahullah for today's talk inshallah ta'ala. So now we start off by reading the hadith, and please follow with me. Reflect and concentrate, you will understand the beauty and the wisdom of the words of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name. Qala al-Imam Muslim rahimahullah. Imam Muslim rahimahullah states, Qala haddathani Abu Khaythama Zuhair ibn Harb Qala haddathana Waki' an Kahmas an Abdullah ibn Buraida an Yahya ibn Ya'mar Qala. Now, all of these names are the narrators of the hadith. They are all from the chain of the narrators of the hadith. Abu Khaythama, Zuhair ibn Harb, Waki' and Kahmas, and Abdullah ibn Buraida, and Yahya ibn Ya'mar. Now, Yahya ibn Ya'mar is the last person at the link at the chain of the hadith. And he states, now he starts narrating the hadith, and he states, Kana awwala man qala fil qadari ma'badun al-juhani. He says that the first person to start talking or, in other words, disputing about Qadr. Allahu Akbar. And Qadr, as we will discuss when we go in the hadith inshallah ta'ala, Qadr is the divine decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the destiny which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written. So he, Yahya ibn Ya'mar, he states that the first person to start disputing or to start talking about the Qadr in a wrong way was Ma'badun al-Juhani. This individual who went by the name Ma'badun al-Juhani. He was the first person to start talking about the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now Yahya ibn Ya'mar, he states, فَانْطَلَقْتُ أَنَا وَحُمَيْدُ ibn عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ الْحِمْيَرِ. Now he says, Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari, the name of another person, Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari, and I, in the sense Yahya ibn Ya'mar, we went to either Mecca or Medina as Hajjain or Mu'tamirain. We went with the intention of Hajj or the intention of Umrah. فَقُلْنَا, and we said, لَوْ لَقِينَا أَحَدًا مِّنْ أَصْحَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, that if we meet any of the companions from the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَسَأَلْنَاهُ عَمَّا يَقُولُ هَؤُلَاءِ فِي الْقَدْرِ, we will ask that particular companion in regard to what these people are talking about the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in regard to what they dispute or argue in regard to the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he goes on to say, فَوُفِّقَ لَنَا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنَ عُمَرْ إِبْنَ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا. Allahu Akbar. And it was, he says that we were blessed with the opportunity or the chance to meet Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma, Abdullah Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma. And we saw him dakhilan al-masjid, he was entering the masjid. Allahu Akbar. So the narration afterwards goes along the lines of these words. They rush to him, both of them. Who are they? Yahya ibn Ya'mar and Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari. Because they said that the first Sahabi we meet, we will go and ask him about these individuals talking about the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they rushed to Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu as he was entering the masjid. And the narration goes along the lines of these words, where he states that both of us, we took to the sides of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. One took to his right side and the other to his left side, and we stopped him to ask him about it. And then they asked him and they informed him about the people who have started disputing and arguing about the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To which Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he states that he goes on to very strongly he stated that, Inform the people who are disputing about the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the people who are talking about the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I, Ibn Umar, I am free of them and they are free of me. In other words, I have nothing to do with them, nor do they have anything to do with me. And then Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he now goes on to narrate the amazing hadith, otherwise known as the hadith of Jibreel. Because he goes on to say, I am free of them and they are free of me. And then he says, قال حدثني أبي عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال. He says, indeed my father Umar رضي الله عنه, he is reported to have said, and now begins the amazing hadith of Jibreel. In other words, the hadith that we are familiar with, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Let me read the hadith. I'll read the complete hadith. Follow with me, and afterwards, inshallah ta'ala, we shall break down the statements. We will translate and explain the hadith as much as possible, inshallah ta'ala. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he states, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم اطلع علينا رجل شديد بياض الثياب شديد سواد الشعر لا يرى عليه أثر السفر ولا يعرفه منا أحد حتى جلس إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأسند ركبتيه إلى ركبتيه ووضع كفيه على فخذيه وقال يا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أخبرني عن الإسلام فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الإسلام أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة وتصوم رمضان وتحج البيت إن استطعت إليه سبيلا. قال صدقت. قال فعجبنا له يسأله ويصدقه. قال فأخبرني عن الإيمان. قال أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره. قال صدقت. قال فأخبرني عن الإحسان. قال أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. قال فأخبرني عن الساعة. قال ما المسؤول عنها بأعلم من السائل. قال فأخبرني عن أماراتها. قال أن تلد الأمة ربتها وأن ترى الحفاة العراة العالة رعاء الشاة يتطاولون في البنيان. قال ثم انطلق فلبثت مليا ثم قال لي يا عمر أتدري من السائل؟ قلت الله ورسوله أعلم. قال فإنه جبريل أتاكم يعلمكم دينكم. الله أكبر. An amazing hadith, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. A hadith full of so many lessons and so much of wisdom to derive from. So we will start off with the beginning of the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in other words, Umar radiallahu anhu, he states, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم. One fine day, we were seated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before I go further, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it is important that we understand that many of the scholars, rahimahumullah, have spoken about this hadith. They have spoken about this hadith, and in books of ahadith, in the books of the explanations of ahadith, they have mentioned that this is an amazing hadith. A hadith comprehensive, but with so much of wisdom in it. A hadith in which many rulings have been derived from, a hadith upon which Islam, upon which Iman, upon which Ihsan is based on. Allahu Akbar. A very famous, a very beautiful, and a very authentic hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he states, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم. One fine day, we were seated with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now before we go further, let us derive a wisdom from this first statement. From this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, scholars highlight that it is very important that we participate in circles of knowledge, in halaqat. Just as how the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in used to spend time with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as Umar radiallahu anhu states, we were seated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it is of utmost importance that we give a lot of importance, we attach importance to, number one, seeking knowledge. And how do we seek knowledge? We try as much as possible to seek knowledge, even though our times have evolved so much to the extent that now we have online conferences, we have webinars. We aren't saying that those are blameworthy. Nay, rather, contemporary scholars have stated that even those kind of gatherings get the same reward, inshallah ta'ala, in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But nevertheless, in whatever way possible, whether it be online, whether it be in the real world, we try and seek as much as knowledge possible. Because after all, we know that our religion is knowledge-based. The more we seek knowledge, the more we will understand in regard to our religion, and the more we will enjoy worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and knowing about Islam. So this is what can be derived from the first statement of the hadith, that one fine day we were seated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then what happens? اِطَّلَعَ عَلَيْنَا رَجُلٌ شَدِيدُ بَيَاضِ الثِّيَابِ شَدِيدُ سَوَادِ الشَّعْرِ. Suddenly a man approaches the gathering. Allahu Akbar. We were seated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and suddenly a man approaches the gathering, a man wearing sparkling white clothes. Shadidu bayadi thiyab. He was wearing sparkling white clothes. Shadidu sawadi sha'ar. And he had jet black hair. Allahu Akbar. La yura alayhi atharu safar wa la ya'rifuhu minna ahad. No signs of fatigue, no signs of journey could be seen on him. Wa la ya'rifuhu minna ahad. And none of us knew about this individual. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, you see, the amazing thing about the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is at times when we just skim over the hadith, when we just read the hadith, we think perhaps there's nothing At times we think there is not much to the hadith. But then Allahu Akbar, when real scholars, the scholars of Islam, when they look at an at a hadith and the way they bring out pearls and wisdom from that hadith, it's just amazing. Allahu Akbar. Scholars like Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, Imam Muslim rahimahullah, Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, Imam At-Tirmidhi rahimahullah, and the other scholars rahimahumullah, they have brought out so many lessons. Allahu Akbar. Now look at this statement, for example. A man suddenly appeared, or he approached the gathering. He was wearing sparkling white clothes. He had jet black hair. No signs of travel or fatigue could be seen on him. And none of us knew him. Allahu Akbar. Now scholars state that number one, like I said, we should be eager to seek knowledge and take part in various halaqat. And number two, look at the way the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhi majma'in were observing this individual so perfectly, Allahu Akbar. And look at their description, where they describe this man, the way he came, how he was dressed, even in regard to his hair. And also they mention an amazing thing, that no signs of fatigue or a journey could be seen on him. Now the reason they mention this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, because unlike today where we travel in expensive motor vehicles, we travel in luxury, we travel in comfort, we fly in planes, you know, the way of traveling today or the modes of transport today is different, a lot different from how it was those days. Now those days, in general, if you take Medina for example, If a person enters Medina, a person who is new to Medina, the people of Medina would know that he has come in as a traveler, because naturally, the minute he comes in, there will be a lot of signs of fatigue on him, and his clothes can never be sparkling white. His clothes would have to be full of dust, because he has to cross deserts and come. And likewise, he cannot have jet black, smooth, crisp hair. He will be having disheveled hair after coming from the journey. But now the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhi majma'in, they observed something very amazing. We don't know this individual, we haven't seen him, but then he comes in as if he has come in a few days back, had a nice shower, had a good rest, and he's coming. Because in general, if a new traveler were to enter Medina, news would go around quickly and people would know, oh, so and so has come and he's a new person to the city. But this particular individual who comes and approaches the gathering, he comes with sparkling white clothes. It is as if he has stopped halfway in the journey, taken a shower, got dressed and everything, and he's coming in smart, looking smart, clean and crisp. Allahu Akbar. So the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhi majma'in, at the very inception, or for that matter Umar radiallahu anhu, who is narrating the hadith, knew that there was something surprising, or something that, you know, you could not really place your finger on in regard to this individual, because he's coming in with sparkling white clothes, he's coming in with jet black hair, and no signs of fatigue or journey can be seen on him, and none of us know him. So if that's the case, then he must have taken some other mode of transport to get here so crisp and so clean. Allahu Akbar. Look at this observance. In other words, look at this sharp or keen eyes of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhi majma'in, which highlights their observant attitude. Allahu Akbar. And this is very important for a student of knowledge, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. A student of knowledge must not be in ghafla. He should not be negligent. He should be very sharp, very keen and very observant. And we see many incidents in the lives of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Ta'ala alayhi majma'in, where they ask very keen questions from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not because they want to question Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nay, rather because they're so sincere and that they so ardently want to seek knowledge, they want to know more about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also other wisdoms that can be derived from this particular statement, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that if a student wishes to enter a gathering of knowledge, it is upon him to dress the best clothes available. Allahu Akbar. And preferably, he should wear white. Preferably, he should wear white and he should comb his hair. He should wear the best clothes possible when he goes to enter or when he goes to seek knowledge in a particular circle of knowledge. This is also another wisdom or another lesson that can be derived from this amazing hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because we see this individual who is now going to go sit by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about Islam, about Iman, about Ihsan. So he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam as a student. So from this we understand or we derive many etiquettes for a talibul ilm, a student of knowledge, in regard to how he should behave with his teacher, in regard to how he should acquire knowledge, in regard to adab, in regard to etiquettes, and in regard to the manners he should follow, he should adopt when he is in a particular circle of knowledge. Allahu Akbar. Imam Malik, rahimahullah, the great Imam Malik, he used to teach hadith in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because after all we know Imam Malik rahimahullah was from Medina. His students used to say that whenever Imam Malik rahimahullah used to attend his gathering where he used to teach hadith, he used to wear the best clothes available with him. He used to wear the best clothes or the cleanest of clothes that he used to have with him, and he used to adorn himself with the best perfume available, because he used to say, I am going to articulate or I am going to teach the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Likewise, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we are seated here today, we aren't discussing something about dunya, nay, we are talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are talking about his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We are talking about the words of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. May Allah the Almighty accept us, and may He the Almighty grant us high stations in Jannah, and may He the Almighty open the doors of goodness and open the doors of beneficial knowledge for all of us. Ameen. Now we move on to the next sentence in the hadith where Umar radiallahu anhu states, حتى جلس إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Before we go further, a tiny disclaimer. Like I said even in the previous session, whilst I was prepping for today's talk, it's just amazing. I mean, it's very difficult to encompass. There's a lot more to touch on even in the previous sentences which we just covered. Some scholars, rahimahumullah, in terms of even my teachers, we used to actually have around 10 or 15 sessions or perhaps a week or two to cover an amazing hadith like this, because there are so many lessons. Allahu Akbar. Just as how a diver, when he dives into the ocean and each time he comes out with a beautiful pearl, each time you open up this amazing hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you can come out with a new pearl. Because after all, we know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty blessed him where he was known as Jawami'ul Kalim. In other words, very concise in words. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would say a word or two, but then Allahu Akbar, you would have an ocean of meanings and an ocean of wisdom that you could derive from those few words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah the Almighty has blessed us to be from the blessed ummah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So moving to the next sentence, hatta jalasa ila nabiyyi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now this man, the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in were observing him. He comes with sparkling white clothes, he comes with jet black hair, and what does he do? حتى جلس إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He goes through the gathering and goes and sits by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. الله أكبر. He goes and sits by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. فأسند ركبتيه إلى ركبتيه. الله أكبر. He goes and he places his knees by the knees of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And from this we understand, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that he used the posture of tashahhud. Because if you were to sit cross-legged, you can't touch your knees with the knees of your teacher. But on the other hand, if you go sit in tashahhud, in the manner, in the posture of tashahhud, then yes, your knees are right in front of you. And this also shows that even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in the same posture. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was not seated cross-legged, but rather there's a high possibility that he would have been seated in the posture of tashahhud, making it easy for this newcomer, this man who came in, to go and sit by him in a manner where his knees were touching the knees of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now once again, this highlights the respect a student must have towards his teacher. It highlights adab. It highlights respect. It highlights manners. It highlights etiquettes. In other words, how a student of knowledge must sit in a gathering of knowledge, in a gathering of seeking knowledge. And likewise, how he should sit in front of his teacher. Allahu Akbar. These are lessons that can be derived from this amazing hadith. And what does this man do now? وَوَضَعَ كَفَّيْهِ عَلَى فَخِذَيْهِ وَوَضَعَ كَفَّيْهِ عَلَى فَخِذَيْهِ He places his hands. He places his hands, وَوَضَعَ كَفَّيْهِ in the sense he places his palms, عَلَى فَخِذَيْهِ in the sense on his thighs. Now this is a direct translation. عَلَى فَخِذَيْهِ He places his palms on his thighs. Now the question could arise, whose thighs? Now there's a difference of opinion amongst the scholars, some of whom state that he placed his palms on the thighs of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because now if we were to sit in the posture of tashahud, we would understand that if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this further establishes the fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was seated in the posture of tashahud, and this newcomer, this individual, he went and sat by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, placing his knees. In other words, his knees were touching the knees of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And some scholars state that he placed his palms on the thighs of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahu Akbar, what a beautiful and what a blessed opportunity. How I envy that I could not place my hands on the thighs of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah the Almighty open the doors of goodness for us. But then there are other scholars who state that no, ala fakhidayhi in the sense that pronoun fakhidayh, the dhamir huwa rajun ila hadha rajul, in the sense that pronoun indicates to this individual himself. He sat by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he placed his palms on his own thighs, in other words, humbling himself in front of his teacher. Allahu Akbar, once again highlighting adab, highlighting manners, highlighting respect in how you should sit in front of your teacher. You don't go sitting in front of your teacher like a proud student, where even some of my teachers, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them, they were very strict. They were very strict when we used to seek knowledge, where they wouldn't allow us to sit cross-legged. They wouldn't allow us to lean by the walls, saying that this is not something, this is not respect you show towards knowledge, number one, nor is it respect that you show towards your teacher. At that time, we used to get annoyed. We used to get annoyed and we used to think, why is he such a... At times we used to even say, why is he being such a pain in the neck? But Allahu Akbar, now we realize the value. Because the more respect you show towards knowledge, the more respect you show towards your teachers, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the doors of beneficial knowledge for you. And also your heart is humbled, you are filled with tawadu', and these are lessons derived from the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by you sitting in such a way, you are enlightening, or you are living the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allahu Akbar, as we go further, we will understand, we will come to know that this student was not any ordinary man, but rather Archangel Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. And if Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, Allahu Akbar, Aminul Wahi, Archangel, the greatest angel, the one who has been given the responsibility of delivering wahi to the prophets alayhi salatu wasalam, if he can come and sit in such a humble posture, what is stopping us from sitting in that posture? Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us and may he forgive our sins. So scholars rahimahumullah, well, after all, you see, it's not a hard and fast rule. Perhaps some find it difficult. Some may have back problems, and some also, you know, even I find it difficult to sit for a long time in the posture of tashahud. So this is a manner that you can adopt. Rather, at the very inception of the gathering, perhaps, or at the very inception of the lesson, you start off by sitting in the posture of tashahud, and gradually you can switch in accordance to facilitate itself for you, because لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها, because after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not burden a soul more than that it can endure. So Allah the Almighty knows what is best, inshallah ta'ala. Nevertheless, now coming back to the hadith, even this statement that we just covered, like I said, highlights the etiquettes of a seeker of knowledge. There's a beautiful statement of a very great imam, Allahu Akbar, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahimahullah. He states, this is just amazing, and when you think of this, you understand that, you know, we are nothing, we number one, we don't even consider ourselves scholars, we consider ourselves students of knowledge. But even in comparison to this great student of knowledge, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah, we are nothing. He says, I spent 30 years, Allahu Akbar, I spent 30 years learning manners, Allahu Akbar. I spent 30 years learning adab. I spent 30 years learning the etiquettes of seeking knowledge. And I spent 20 years seeking knowledge, Allahu Akbar. Because through the journey of seeking knowledge, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it is of utmost importance that we learn or we adopt the manners of a talibul ilm, the manners of a student of knowledge, resulting, like I said, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opening amazing doors of beneficial knowledge for all of us. Coming back to the hadith, now the student of knowledge is seated in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he says, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akhbirni anil Islam. Now, something that needs to be highlighted here is, in general, the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, the ones who are close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, generally used to address Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Ya Nabi Allah, or Prophet of Allah, or Ya Rasulullah, or Messenger of Allah. They would never address Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam using his name. But on the other hand, Bedouins and Arabs who used to come from out, who were not close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and especially Bedouins, because Bedouins at times can be very rough natured. They can be a bit harsh. So they used to come in and they used to address Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam using his name, Ya Muhammad. So likewise, this individual, as he wasn't a person who was with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a newcomer who had come in. He says, Ya Muhammad, please don't forget to say salawat. When I mention the name of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is upon us to say salawat sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because we know of the hadith of three ameens, where one of the du'as that Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam himself made was that, let destruction be upon the one who hears your name, Ya Rasulullah, and does not make salawat. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam capped off that du'a. He sealed that du'a with ameen. Allahu Akbar. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam, the greatest angel making du'a, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying ameen to it. So let us not be from that group upon whom destruction has been decreed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. So let us remember salawat whenever I mention the beautiful name of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, Akhbirni anil Islam. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell me about Islam. Allahu Akbar. And now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states, فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now he states, الإسلام, Islam is, أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. Islam is to testify, is to bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. وَتُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ, and to establish salah. وَتُؤْتِيَ الزَّكَاةِ, to give out the poor, to give out the zakah. وَتَسُومَ رَمَضَانِ, and to fast the month of Ramadan. وَتَحُجَّ الْبَيْتَ إِنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, and to also perform pilgrimage to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you have the means to do so. Allahu Akbar. Now, this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, highlights the fundamentals of Islam. In other words, the pillars of Islam. Islam is founded on these five pillars. Allahu Akbar. And this is highlighted to us in this amazing and famous hadith of Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam starts off by saying, pillar number one is to bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. Now, in the previous session, in the tafsir of the greatest verse, Ayatul Kursi, we discussed on how the kalima is. In other words, we broke down the kalima into two parts, where we have negation and then confirmation. This is to establish an emphasis that there is no deity worthy of worship at all other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, it is important, it is part of our testimony, it is part of us bearing witness, that we have to also state that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, you see, our religion is so powerful. Allahu Akbar. For example, if you look at, say, any other religion for that matter, if you take Buddhism, you don't have a specific mantra or a specific statement that you have to utter to enter Buddhism. Buddhism is rather a way of life. You know, in reality, you know, a person can be a Christian and he can even follow the code of Buddhism. There is no need that he has to embrace Buddhism as a religion. For that matter, if you take Hinduism, Hinduism also is similar. I mean, there is no particular testimony of faith that you have to utter to enter the fold of Hinduism. Any religion you take for that matter, Christianity, Judaism, any religion, unlike our beautiful religion, our powerful religion, Islam is such a powerful religion that you can't just think, okay, I want to become a Muslim and then you won't become a Muslim. You have to utter, you have to articulate the testimony of faith. And from this we understand, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us in regard to our faculty of speech, Allahu Akbar. With this tiny tongue of ours, we can make ourselves worthy of Jannah. And likewise, we can throw ourselves out of the fold of Islam by uttering things that do not befit a Muslim. Allahu Akbar. So it is upon us to be very careful in regard to what we speak. A narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said along the lines of these words, that the individual who looks after what is between his jaws, i.e. his tongue, and he looks after what is between his legs, i.e. his private parts, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is stating, I shall guarantee him a place in Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. And I have said this before too, that our Salafun as-Salih, our pious predecessors, they used to be so careful. They used to be so careful that in terms of their speech, that at times they used to fill their mouths with tiny pebbles so that they don't indulge in vain speech. They don't indulge in vain talk. Allahu Akbar. Because just as how my beloved Shaykh Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah states, he is also known as a specialist of the heart. He states that one of the things that harden an individual's heart is vain speech. Allahu Akbar. Unnecessary talking, unnecessary speech that do not benefit us either in this world or the hereafter results in our hearts becoming hard. Allahu Akbar. Psychologists did a survey and they came up to a conclusion that an average adult, he articulates 10,000 words per day. He articulates 10,000 words per day. I may have said this before, but I'm mentioning again to highlight on how careful we must be. And they go on to say that women, on the other hand, they articulate double the amount. They articulate 20,000 words. Allahu Akbar. So it is upon us, to gauge these 10,000 words or 20,000 words and see whether how many of these words, Allahu Akbar, are pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or at least benefiting us in this world or the hereafter. Because most of the time, what we speak, illa man rahim Allah, except those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed His mercy upon, at times what we speak do not benefit us in this world nor the hereafter. At times what we speak endangers another person's honor. At times we waste good speech on backbiting and gossiping and carrying tales about people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. So it is from the pillars of Islam, the first pillar of Islam, to bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. Now, when we look at the definition of Islam, before we go on to the next pillar of Islam, the definition of Islam is that if you refer to most of the dictionaries, the Arabic language dictionaries, you will find out that the meaning of the word Islam means submission. In other words, submission to the will of your creator, your maker. This is what Islam means. It also stems from the root that gives the meaning peace, but the primary meaning is submission, i.e. submission to the will of your creator, the will of your maker. This is what Islam means. In other words, humbling oneself, establishing ubudiyya, establishing that you are a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obeying the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, heeding the prohibitions, staying away from all those things that transgress the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and sincerely worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believing in all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to us through the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wa salam, and having faith in all of that. This is Islam in a nutshell. Allahu Akbar. So now after the Shahada, and yes, before we move on to Salah, Shahada is something so powerful, this testimony of faith, that there was once an incident during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Usama radiallahu anhu, once on the battlefield, he was about to kill a person. He was about to kill a person. And just as perhaps when he was raising his sword to kill him, that man utters the testimony of faith. He bears witness that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But ignoring the testimony of faith, Usama radiallahu anhu killed that individual. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very perturbed and very disturbed about it. He asks Usama radiallahu anhu, "Ya Usama," along the lines of these words, "you killed him even after he bore witness or after he uttered the testimony of faith." Usama radiallahu anhu tried to explain, "Ya Rasulullah, he just did it merely out of fear of death. He just did it to get out of that situation he was in." But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so upset that he kept on repeating it. Usama radiallahu anhu says he kept on repeating it so much that I felt so bad, Allahu Akbar, something along the lines of these words. But nevertheless, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so upset in regard to it, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. So like I said, shahada is of two parts, negation and confirmation. And likewise, two parts where we establish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. And it is also upon us to establish the prophethood of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we move on to the next pillar of Islam, and that is tuqim as-salah, to establish salah. Allahu Akbar, that is the second pillar of Islam. And my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, there is no excuse whatsoever for a believer, for a Muslim, to leave salah. There's no excuse unless he is not in a state of his mind that he can, perhaps if he's unconscious or he has gone mad or he is in a state of coma, that is similar to being unconscious, or he has really forgotten, and nisyan in the sense he has actually forgotten. You can't say, now say if someone had reminded you, say about 5-10 minutes before, and you ignore that reminder, then you are held accountable. But say no one reminded you, it completely slipped out of your mind, which is highly unlikely in terms of a believer whose day completely evolves around salah, Allahu Akbar. Because you might notice that we believers, look at how we measure our day. We don't say, I'll meet you at 4 o'clock. But rather, if it's something around 4 o'clock, we will say, I'll meet you after Salatul Asr. We'll say, I'll meet you before Salatul Asr. I'll meet you after Salatul Dhuhr. I'll meet you before Salatul Dhuhr. Or we'll do this after Salatul Maghrib. Our day, we measure our day using the salawat, because we are always mindful of our salawat, of our 5 times prayers. And also because a believer is supposed to say he's finished Salatul Dhuhr, he needs to start planning and getting ready for Salatul Asr. He's done with Salatul Asr, he needs to get ready for Salatul Maghrib. He's done with Salatul Maghrib, he needs to get ready for Salatul Isha. This is how the day of a believer revolves. Allahu Akbar. So how did Salah come about? We know of the narration where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went up on Mi'raj. He went up on Mi'raj, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala initially prescribed 50 salat for a day, 50 salawat for a day, 50 prayers for a day. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes back. On the way, he meets Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam, who advises Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he said, I know that your nation, along the lines of these words, may not be able to shoulder the burden of 50 prayers for a day. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes back and it reduces by 10. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribes 40. And this back and forth happens a few times until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought it down to 5 times a day. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the way back, again Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam says, go back, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reduce it further. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, states that I'm ashamed that even now after it has been reduced to 5, to go back and reduce it further. Allahu Akbar. In reality, we must consider our 5 times salawat a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a programming that we go through. We need. Allah does not need our salah. On the other hand, we need this salah, this blessed salah, where this divine link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But sadly, we have individuals today who state that, you know what, in vain, oh Allah, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should have gone back and reduced it to another perhaps 2 or 3. Maybe if we could have knocked off Salatul Fajr and Salatul Isha, which is the most tough, and just Dhuhr and Asr or Dhuhr and Maghrib, would have made things so easy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the doors of goodness for us. So the second pillar of Islam is Salah. And the next, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is Zakah. وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة. It is upon us to give zakah. It is one of the obligatory pillars of zakah. Allahu Akbar. In today's time, we know, scholars mention that if the whole Muslim ummah, if the whole Muslim ummah were to give out their zakah perfectly, we would be able to eradicate poverty amongst the Muslims. Allahu Akbar. But sadly, we know of how many people suffering out of hunger. Now, inshallah ta'ala, I hope to take part in a very beautiful and blessed initiative, otherwise known as the Night of Power. I think the poster is put up upstairs. And this is with a noble intention of gathering or collecting funds to eradicate or feed the to eradicate poverty, and to also feed the ones who are hungry, to feed families who are suffering from hunger and poverty. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the initiative and bless the organizers and make it an outstanding success. Inshallah ta'ala, it will be from the 24th to the 26th of this month, and the details will be uploaded very soon, inshallah ta'ala. It is the first ever global online conference where speakers from all around the world are taking part, where speakers from all around the world will be touching on a theme which is the spiritual journey with the Quran. There will be amazing talks held, inshallah ta'ala, almost around 20 to 25 speakers, out of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also blessed me with an opportunity to participate in. So inshallah ta'ala, if possible, go through the details and try and participate in it, and try and donate for this worthy cause. And likewise, try and pass the message around friends and family, whether they be locally or abroad, so that all of them can be a part of this blessed initiative. Nevertheless, coming back to zakah, if you look at the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, that many a place Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has joined salah and zakah together to highlight the importance of zakah and salah. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he states, in regard to, there are three ayat in the Quran that are linked together. Number one being aqimus salah wa atu zakah. You should establish your salah and give out your zakah. The second being anishkur li bali walidayk, in terms of your the good treatment towards your parents, you're supposed to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and likewise thank your parents. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he states that in regard to these ayat, the speciality or the important thing that needs to be highlighted is that both of these two things go hand in hand. In other words, if someone were to say, you know, I'm going to establish salah but I'm not going to pay zakah, then salah is not accepted from that individual. Or if he were to say, I'm going to pay zakah but I'm not praying my salah, then the zakah is not accepted from that individual. It has to go hand in hand, where he has to establish salah and likewise he has to pay out zakah. Both of these two things have to go hand in hand, and both are of utmost importance. Allahu Akbar. The next pillar, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is Sawm Ramadan, is fasting. Allahu Akbar. And the first fasting that was made obligatory upon the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the fasting of the day of Ashura. Afterwards, the obligation of the fasting of the month of Ramadan came about, and alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are in the blessed month of Ramadan. And this month of Ramadan, i.e. fasting in the month of Ramadan, is an obligation, is from the fundamentals and the pillars of Islam. The next pillar, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is Hajj, performing pilgrimage, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those who have the means to do so. Sadly, today we have individuals running around in expensive motor vehicles, women folk decking themselves with expensive jewelry. But then when you ask them about Hajj, they say, you know what, we're still collecting money, or we're still trying to, you know, arrange our funds to make it for Hajj. Allahu Akbar. Priority must be given for Hajj, where the obligation falls off from us, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as it is from the fundamentals of Islam. And it is best that we do it when we have strength, and not wait till old age and senility overtakes us and we expect our children to perhaps send us on Hajj. Rather, we try to do it when we are young, and we fulfill this pillar of Islam in such a way that we have the strength to fulfill the pillar of Islam in beauty and excellence. Allahu Akbar. Now, swiftly moving on to the next statement, this individual, now what he does is, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained the pillars of Islam, now he went as a student And he was the one who asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about Islam. But then he says something, a statement that amazed the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in. He said, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam explained about the five pillars of Islam, he states, Sadaqt. He says, Sadaqt. You have spoken the truth. Allahu Akbar. He looks at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and confirms what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam just said. So the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they stayed. فَعَجِبْنَا لَهُ يَسْأَلُهُ وَيُصَدِّقُ. We were surprised. We were surprised in regard to this individual. He comes and he asks from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam as if he does not know about this. And then he himself confirms. He says, you have spoken the truth. Because in general, if you say you have spoken the truth, that means he already knows the answer. So why is he doing this? Whilst they were wondering about this, he asks the next question from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِيمَانِ. Inform me about Iman. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then answers that question by stating, أَنْ تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُولِهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَتُؤْمِنَ بِالْقَدْرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِّهِ. Iman is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in the books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to believe in the last day, and to believe in qadr, that good and evil is from it. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, before we delve into this particular statement, it is important that we touch on the difference between Islam and Iman. Now we already defined what Islam is. Now in terms of Iman, before we go into the definition of Iman, what we need to understand is al-Islamu wal-Imanu idha jitama'a iftaraqa wa idha iftaraqa ijtama'a. That Islam and Iman, when you join them together, they are two different things. When you join them together, they are two different things. But if they are separate, then they are one and the same thing. I will explain. When we talk about Islam, what we mean is the exterior actions of an individual. Because look at the pillars. Shahada, you articulate it. It's an action. Salah is an action. Zakah, you pay out your zakah. These are all zakah, Ramadan, Hajj. All of this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is in terms of your exterior actions. But if you look at Iman, Iman is nothing exterior, but rather it deals with your beliefs from within. Allahu Akbar. It deals with your beliefs from within. So when you look at Iman in general, you would say that Iman is much more a general term than Islam. Iman is a much more general term than Islam. Because every mu'min is a Muslim, but not every Muslim is a mu'min. I hope I'm not confusing anybody. Every mu'min is a Muslim, but not every Muslim is a mu'min. Just as how we would say every crow is black in color, but not every black color is a crow. Every crow is black in color, but not every black color is a crow. Likewise, every mu'min is a Muslim, but not every Muslim is a mu'min. I hope I have made it clear. Now let me try to elaborate further. Just draw a hypothetical huge circle in your minds. Okay, a huge circle. I don't have a whiteboard to explain to you all, no presentation. So let me just try and do it verbally. Draw a big circle, a huge circle. Now that circle is Iman. Now draw a smaller circle within that big circle. And that is Islam. That is Islam. Yeah. So now you understand that Islam is within Iman. So every mu'min has Islam, but not every Muslim has Iman. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Noble Quran, قَالَتِ الْأَعْرَابُ آمَنَّا قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا أَسْلَمْنَا. Some Arabs, Bedouin Arabs, they said, آمَنَّا, we have brought in Iman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا, say that you haven't brought in Iman, وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا أَسْلَمْنَا, but rather you all should say that you have embraced Islam. Because the minute you embrace Islam, you have to bring in all of these articles of faith to become a mu'min. So to elaborate further, the first daraja, the first rank is Muslim, and then you become a mu'min, and then you become a muhsin, which is the pinnacle, which I hope time will permit to touch inshallah ta'ala. So, like I said, if you talk about Islam and Iman together, then they are two different things. But then if they are separate, they are one and the same thing, Islam and Iman. Because within Iman is Islam, within Iman is Islam. But if you take within Islam, Iman does not come into it. Because the minute a person becomes a Muslim, he does not become a mu'min. But a mu'min is already a Muslim. Now, in terms of the definition of Iman, what is Iman? Iman is to believe in all of these six articles of faith. And it also entails three important factors. Number one, you can't just say, okay, before we go into the three important factors, you just can't say, I believe in Allah, I believe in the angels, the books, and all the six articles of faith. That does not make you a mu'min. Allahu Akbar. Three important factors need to be established. And this many people are not aware of, sadly, because of the lack of aqeedah being taught. Many people are not aware of their own creed. Allahu Akbar. This is a very sad thing, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate that ignorance from the ummah currently. So number one, from these three important factors in regard to Iman is iqrarum bil qalb. Iqrarum bil qalb is that you have to establish the belief in your heart. You have to, there is no point in just articulating it using your tongue saying, I believe in Allah, but when your heart does not believe in Allah. When your heart is questioning your faith. When your heart thinks, is there really a creator? Is there really a creator? Or, you know what, shall we just stick to Darwin's theory perhaps? Or shall we just, you know what, stick to what that scientist said or this scientist said? If your heart is like a stick in the mud, Allahu Akbar, your Iman is weak and you need to work on your Iman. Number one, iqrarum bil qalb. Your heart has to fully accept the six articles of faith. Number two, nutqum bil lisan. It wouldn't suffice only that your heart accepts it and you don't articulate it. Your tongue also has to articulate it. You have to accept it with your heart. Your tongue has to articulate it. Number three, and then your limbs have to start emitting all kinds of good deeds. In other words, you have to establish salah. You have to give out zakah. You have to fast the month of Ramadan. You have to go on hajj. All of these good deeds have to start coming out from the limbs. Amalum bil jawarih. So the three factors, number one, for the ones who are making notes, let me repeat it. Number one, iqrarum bil qalb. Number one, iqrarum bil qalb. You believe firmly with your heart. Number two, nutqum bil lisan. You articulate it with your tongue. Number three, amalum bil jawarih. Number three, amalum bil jawarih. That you can't just say, you know what, I have articulated it with my tongue. I believe in Allah, but I'm not going to pray. Then you don't become a mu'min. You have to articulate it with your tongue. You have to believe it firmly with your heart. And likewise, you have to involve in all of the actions that has been prescribed upon a believer. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the believers. To touch on it further, scholars mention, this is a little more easier way to remember these things. Scholars mention that Iman consists of five nunat. Iman consists of five nunat. Now what is nunat? Nunat is not some kind of a thing that you would eat for breaking fast. Nunat is the plural of noon. The letter noon in Arabic, you have the letter noon. If you want to say a plural of noon, nunat. So basically we are saying five noons. Five noons in the English. Five noons. Yeah. So to easily perhaps memorize these five factors, you have five nunat. So let us touch on these five nunat. The first noon is qawlum bil lisan. You see the noon at the end, qawlum bil lisan. The first noon is qawlum bil lisan, where you articulate using your tongue. The second noon is tasdeequm bil jinan. Again, another noon at the end. Tasdeequm bil jinan. In other words, you confirm with your heart. Jinan means your heart. Tasdeequm bil qalb or jinan is another word you use for heart. So tasdeequm bil jinan, you confirm with your heart. That is the second noon. The third noon is amalum bil arkan. Again, another noon. You have to do all of the actions that have been prescribed upon a believer. All of those actions have to come from his limbs. Arkan means limbs. Rukn arkan means limbs. So for, number one, قَوْلٌ بِاللِّسَانِ. Number two, تَصْدِيقٌ بِالْجِنَانِ. Number three, عَمَلٌ بِالْأَرْكَانِ. Number four, يَزِيدُ بِطَاعَةِ الرَّحْمَانِ. Now in terms of Iman, Iman increases and decreases. Our Iman increases and decreases. If you take the Iman of the angels, it's stable. You see, our Iman is like an equalizer. It goes up and down. It goes up and down. The angel, the Iman of the angels is stable. It's just in one fixed, locked position. It does not go up. It does not go down. The position that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for it, it remains there. And that is why, لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. And that is why they do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They do what they are commanded to do. Allahu Akbar. But the Iman of the Anbiya, the Prophets alayhimu salatu wasalam, keeps on increasing. It never ever comes down. It just keeps increasing, increasing, increasing. Allahu Akbar. But we the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Iman increases and decreases. And that is why suddenly we feel the surge to do good deeds. We suddenly feel, we feel very pious and very righteous. We want to do good deeds. And sometimes we feel as if we are spiritually punctured. And we feel empty, we feel down, we feel low. Because of that Yazid Yankus, because of the Iman increasing and decreasing. So the fourth noon is Yazidu bi ta'ati ar-Rahman. If you obey Ar-Rahman, if you obey Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, that is Allah, your Iman will keep increasing. The more you do good deeds, the more you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Iman will increase. And the final, the fifth noon is, وَيَنْقُسُ بِطَاعَةِ الشَّيْطَانِ. You see? Number one, قَوْلٌ بِاللِّسَانِ, noon at the end. تَصْدِيقٌ Number two, تَصْدِيقٌ بِالْجِنَانِ, noon at the end. عَمَلٌ بِالْأَرْكَانِ, noon at the end. يَزِيدُ بِطَاعَةِ الرَّحْمَانِ, noon at the end. And the final one, يَنْقُسُ بِطَاعَةِ الشَّيْطَانِ. And your Iman decreases when you obey Shaitan. When you obey Shaitan, his evil inclinations, his urges, his evil whisperings, when you give in to Shaitan, your Iman starts to deplete and starts to dwindle. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. And may Allah the Almighty strengthen and fortify our Iman. Ameen. So, now also to establish the fact that Iman consists of actions and articulations and also confirmation with your heart, there is this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, "Al-Imanu bid'u wa sab'una shu'ba. Fa'a'laha qawlu la ilaha illallah wa adnaha imatatul adha 'anit tariq." Iman is what? 70 odd branches. Iman is of 70 odd branches. Now we're talking about Iman here. The topmost or the pinnacle of it is what? قَوْلُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. Articulating لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. So from that we understand نُطُقُم بِاللِّسَانِ. It is you're articulating it using your tongue. وَأَذِنَاهَا. And the lowest branch of Iman is what? إِمَاتَةُ الْأَذَىٰ أَنِ الطَّرِيقِ. Taking something harmful away from the path. Taking something harmful that might harm another person from the path. Now doing that, is that an action or not? Is that an action? So then عَمَلٌ بِالْأَرْكَانِ. So we understand. So Iman entails عَمَلٌ بِالْأَرْكَانِ, عَمَلٌ بِالْأَرْكَانِ, نُطُقٌ بِاللِّسَانِ, and تَصْدِيقٌ بِالْجِنَانِ. Three important factors. If all of these factors are met, if all of these conditions are met, only then will an individual's Iman become perfect, become complete in his heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with perfect and complete Iman. So article number one, أَنْ تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ, that you are supposed to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will not delve into this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, because in the previous session, in the tafsir of Ayatul Kursi, we touched on the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is upon us to believe in the grandeur and the greatness of our powerful Creator. وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ. And then we are supposed to, the second article, we are supposed to believe in the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now in regard to the angels, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, you can't just say, I believe in the angels and then cap it off. No. You have to believe in the angels. You have to believe in the angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned their names, such as Jibril, such as Mika'il, such as Israfil, such as Malakul Maut, and the other angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned their names, or perhaps Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned their names, perhaps Munkar and Nakir. So it is upon us to believe in all of these angels, and we are also supposed to believe in their responsibilities. If we have been taught those responsibilities by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For example, that Jibril alaihi salatu wasalam has been entrusted the responsibility of wahi. Mikail alaihi salatu wasalam has been entrusted with the responsibility of the rains and the provisions. Israfil alayhi salatu wasalam has been entrusted the responsibility of blowing the trumpet. He has already placed the trumpet on his lips, waiting for the signal or the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to blow the trumpet to signal the commencement of the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. And likewise, Malakul Maut, that he has been given the responsibility of taking souls. Allahu Akbar. Now you see, in Malakul Maut, some people say that his name is Israel. But this has not been established in any way from any authentic hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or from the Quran. But rather, what has been established is that he is known as Malakul Maut. So we stick to what is authentic and what has been taught to us from the Quran. So we say that his name, or he is known as Malakul Maut, the angel of death. And that particular name, Israel, has not been established. And then in terms of the books, أَنْتُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ, in terms of the books, the revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are supposed to believe in all the revelations that came down, the established revelations, such as the Torah, such as the Injil, such as Suhufi Ibrahim wa Musa, the books of Musa, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, and Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. We believe in all of those books, but the current conclusion that we have to bring about is that all of those books have been tampered. What we have to initially believe is those books are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But currently they have been tampered and they have been distorted. And currently no book is safe from distortion or tampering other than the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the noble Quran. There is a mention in the books of history about one particular Jewish rabbi. He used to work as a he used to work in a press where, you know, in those days they didn't have modern technology where they used to, you know, they didn't have big publications and stuff like that. They used to basically write books, you know, manuscripts and copies, etc. So he was working in this particular press where they used to write the books of different religions, such as the Bible perhaps, and then the books of Judaism, etc. So he says, many a time, you know, it's not technology in the sense they didn't have advanced technology as how we have today, where you have autocorrect and etc. and all these things. They had to write. So many a time there would be printing errors. But then the followers of Judaism never came back complaining of errors, nor did the Christians ever come back complaining of errors in terms of the Bible. Then he says, one day we sold a Quran, and the very next day that Muslim, he comes back saying, you know what, I don't want this Quran because a page is missing. You have missed out a page. This man, the minute he heard it, he asked him, how do you know that? To which he says that most of us, alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, most of us are from the Huffadul Quran. We have memorized the Quran. Allah the Almighty has made it so easy because this is the only book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself took the responsibility of protecting it. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun. We are the ones who reveal this book and we will protect it. Allahu Akbar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected it and he will protect it. And the minute that Jewish rabbi witnessed that, he immediately uttered the kalima and he embraced Islam. Allahu Akbar. Books of history mention this particular incident. Nevertheless, it is upon us to believe in the books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, we are supposed to believe in the Rusul and the Anbiya. Now, this is the thing that we have to touch on a bit. أَنْتُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ. We are supposed to believe in the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when we talk about the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have the Rusul and the Anbiya. We have the Nabi and we have the Rasul. We are supposed to believe in all of them. But what is the difference between a Nabi and between a Rasul? And I would say the best explanation in regard to this is the explanation of Shaykhul Islam, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He states that the difference between a Rasul and a Nabi is that a Nabi was inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with revelation, but he was not commanded to do tabligh of that. He was not commanded to do tabligh. Now what is tabligh? Tabligh means to convey the message. In other words, to make da'wah. He was not commanded to make da'wah. A Nabi was given, was inspired, was blessed with wahi, but was not commanded to make da'wah, to call people. But on the other hand, a Rasul, and that is why we translate Nabi as prophet and Rasul as messenger. Rasul is a person who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired and blessed with wahi and also commanded tabligh upon him. He was commanded to make da'wah, to call people towards the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once again, a Rasul is a person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired and blessed him with wahi, but he was commanded to make tabligh, to convey the message and call people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A Nabi is an individual who was inspired, was blessed with wahi, but was not commanded to make tabligh or call people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he furthermore states a more comprehensive conclusion is that, and this is the statement of the majority of the scholars, they state that both Nabi and Rasul, both were inspired, both were given wahi, and both were commanded with tabligh, both were commanded to make da'wah, but the differentiating factor between both of them is that a Nabi is generally sent to a nation that agrees with him. A Nabi is sent to a nation that generally agrees with him, and a Rasul is sent to a nation who is against him, who he has to work on. For example, look at Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and Harun alayhi salatu wasalam. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was a Rasul. He was a Rasul. Harun alayhi salatu wasalam was a Nabi. Now, the explanation fits perfectly because Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was sent to call Banu Israel towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And afterwards, after they had embraced or turned towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after they had accepted the message to some extent, Harun alayhi salatu wasalam was made a Nabi. So now things were made easier for him. He did not have to work a lot because the nation was already in accordance to the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the slight differentiating factors between Rasul and Nabi. Now the other thing about the belief in terms of Rusul is that we have to believe in all of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, our father Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, until our beloved prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Now for example, another example, just as Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, is that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was a Nabi. He was a Nabi. He wasn't a Rasul. He was a Nabi. He did not come and make strong tabligh and strong da'wah. Who was the next? Who do you think was the next great prophet who was titled as a Rasul? Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Exactly. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was the next great prophet, messenger, Rasul, who came and called people towards Islam because they had diverted and they had gone astray. They had been misguided. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was sent as a Rasul and he called the people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we believe in all of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are many narrations and opinions to state the number of the prophets, but most of them have not been established. So we stick to the statement that there was a great number of prophets. Some scholars state 124,000, 125,000 and so many other figures. But still, majority of the scholars state that there are exact or precise number has not been mentioned anywhere. It's just that we know that a huge number, a great jama'ah of prophets were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we believe in all of them, and we believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the final messenger and he is the seal of all of the prophets and the greatest of all of the prophets. Allahu Akbar. Okay, we move on to the next. أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر. That we have to believe in the last day, in the day of judgment. Now, it is upon us to believe that the day of judgment will inevitably occur, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to resurrect us, and there is going to be a questioning that will take place. So in terms of believing in the day of judgment, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we have to believe in terms of the first marhala. In other words, the first station that we have to cross in terms of our journey towards al-akhirah, and that is the qabr. We have to believe in the qabr. There are some people who don't believe in what happens in the qabr. We have to believe of all that will take place in the qabr that has been taught to us by our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After all of that was taught to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. He does not speak out of his own desires. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ. Whatever he speaks is divine inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to believe in regard to the qabr, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said that there will be angels who will question us in the grave, and there will be questions that will be put forward to us, and we have to answer those questions. And if we are successful, if we successfully answer those questions, and that will be the case only if we have strong iman, what will happen is the grave. Another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam states along the lines of these words, that the grave, the minute the son of Adam is put into a grave, the grave will hug him. Allahu Akbar. The grave will hug him. If he is a believer, if he is successful, that hug will be like a friend warmly hugging him. Just imagine the grave hugging you. Allahu Akbar. What a spectacle. The grave will hug you, a warm hug. But on the other hand, if you are a sinner, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all and forgive our sins, the grave will crush us with that hug in such a way our ribs will entangle itself with the other ribs. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. And likewise, if we are successful after the questioning in the grave, a window will be opened. Allahu Akbar. If he is a righteous person, a window will be opened to the fire of Jahannam. Allahu Akbar. If he is a righteous person, a window will be opened to the fire of Jahannam. Allahu Akbar. And it will be said to him, If you had rejected the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this would be your abode, but you are successful, this is not your abode. And then a window towards Jannah will be open to him, and he will start enjoying the beautiful glimpses of Jannah, the beautiful fragrances of Jannah. And then he will cry out, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, make the day of judgment happen now. Make it happen now. I want to go into Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from the people of Jannah. But the minute a sinner, the minute he fails those questioning, a window towards Jannah will be open to him. Look at that remorse and the guilt he will feel, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. And it will be said to him, if only you had believed in Allah, if only you had brought in Iman, if you only had acted upon the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the narration goes along the lines of these words, this would have been your abode. But on the other hand, you were the exact opposite to that. That window of Jannah will be shut, and then a window towards Jahannam will be opened, and he will be said, this is your abode, stare in it. And then the fumes and the heat and the scary things of Jahannam, he will have to face it until the day of Qiyamah, and he will cry out, Ya Allah, do not let the day of Qiyamah take place. Do not let the day of Qiyamah take place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from becoming the people of Jahannam. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. So to believe in the day of judgment is to believe in all of this. To believe in the qabr, to believe in the questioning, and Allahu Akbar, to believe in the hawd, to believe in the hawdul kawthar, to believe in that blessed fountain where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will give all of us sweet water to quench our thirst from Allahu Akbar. And the description in regard to that fountain, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that even one sip from that fountain and we will never ever feel thirst ever again. It's such a quenching fountain. And we will be given to drink through the blessed hands of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is just amazing. That is just out of this world. Allahu Akbar. In reality, it is out of this world. It is in the Akhirah. Allahu Akbar. And there will be a group of people. There will be a group of people who will not be able to drink from the hawd. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will cry out, Ya Allah, they are my ummati. They are from my ummah. They are from my ummah. And then it will be said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The narration goes along the lines of these words. O Rasulullah, you do not know what they did after you. In other words, what they innovated after you. They innovated so many things after you. They do not deserve to drink from the hawdul kawthar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, being so merciful and being so kind, He will ask, Ya Allah, they are my nation. But then it will be said to him, you do not know after you, they committed so much of innovations. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from becoming people of innovations and people of bid'ah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. It is extremely an evil thing. Allahu Akbar. There is nothing known as a good innovation and a bad innovation. According to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, innovations are innovations. كل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار كل محدثة بدعة. Every newly invented matter is a bid'ah. Every bid'ah, every innovation is a misguidance. And every misguidance, you see, there is no exemption, there is no good and bad innovation. All innovations are bad, all innovations are misguidance, and every misguidance is in the fire of Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to stay away from innovations. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as I thought as much, we were not able to complete the hadith. And I will stop here inshallah ta'ala, because the very next statement is about qadr. And qadr requires time. There is a few points that I wish to touch, and time does not suffice to touch inshallah ta'ala. So the coming session, the coming Thursday, the topic is fleet to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we will do is inshallah ta'ala, we will complete the hadith, the beautiful hadith of Jibreel, and then we will touch on fleeing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is in regard to tawbah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, and may He the Almighty accept our good deeds. May He the Almighty bless us, and may He open the doors of goodness for us, and may He the Almighty alleviate the sufferings the Muslim Ummah is going through. Allahu Akbar. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May He the Almighty alleviate the sufferings of the Muslims in Gaza, and may He forgive their sins. May He grant them high stations in Jannah because of the suffering they are going through. May He fill all of our hearts, the hearts of every ummati of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with positivity. Because of the things that we witness happening, our hearts are going negative, and our iman, many people are questioning their iman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with strong iman, unwavering iman. Because after all, we have to go through these trials and calamities. These are all tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are tests to test our iman. And this is the time, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, holding on to your iman will be as if holding on to a piece of coal. Today, many brothers and sisters, they question iman. They question their faith by stating, if there is a maker, or if there is such a merciful creator, why is He allowing all of these things to happen in Palestine and in Gaza? My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, even the people of Gaza, even the people of Palestine don't question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like that. They are going through the trials, but they are bravely and strongly facing those trials. Allahu Akbar. Because they know that this, the life of this dunya is short, and by them going through that trial, they are securing high stations in Jannah. But we, on the other hand, living in luxury, running around in expensive vehicles, eating food and perhaps at times wasting food, living in mansions, we question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we question our maker, we question our faith. Allahu Akbar. We need to be worried about ourselves. We need to work on our iman, and we need to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah blesses us with strong, unwavering iman, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses the people of Gaza, and He blesses them with strong patience, and blesses them with even more courage to go through the trials of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may He the Almighty unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He united us here this morning with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may He grant all of us the opportunity to drink from the beautiful fountain of Kawthar through the blessed hands of our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.